So hello everybody, my name is Andrei Zinoviev. First of all, I would like to thank you, Dima, for this kind invitation. It's an honor for me to conclude this exciting workshop during which I learned many things which I hope will be useful at some point in our research. I work at the Institut Curie, which is a cancer research center. It's distributed in several places in Paris, including the Orsay University, but also center of Paris. And I'm going to talk about biological networks, types of networks, which I believed was not discussed during these 4 days. So I'm kind of will give you some ideas how biological networks, which is one of our main tool in our research, can be approached and understood by Google Matrix idea and some related ideas. So biological networks basically is an attempt to represent in a form of in a graphical form, in the form of graphs, complex biochemistry happening inside a living cell. So this is an example of biological networks which represent a global reconstruction of all metabolic reactions happening inside a human cell. Currently, this reconstruction contains more than 10,000 reactions. Formally speaking, this reconstruction represents a bipartite graph, which is kind of zoomed out here. So here, small squares represent reactions, biochemical reactions, and then by arrows you see chemical substances which can enter into the reactions and come out of the reactions. So this is a kind of classical representation of chemical reaction networks. Metabolism is only a small part of the story. So these metabolic networks, they describe what human cells eat, how they reproduce, because we can talk about metabolism of DNA. But there are two important layers which are connected to these metabolic networks. Important layer of equal and even bigger size can be called signaling networks. So these networks, which also can be represented as chemical reactions, represent how a human cell interacts with an environment, which signals it receives from outside the cell or from other cells, and how this is translated into the changes into metabolism. But also there is an underlying layer of transcriptional networks. So these are the networks which describe how a human cell reads information encoded into DNA, how it reads from template in a cell type specific manner, and again how these instructions encoded into DNA are translated into other layers of signaling. So this is a very rough representation of what we call biological networks. The dream of the science which is called systems biology is to create global mathematical model, dynamical model of these networks, which is for the moment is more or less hopeless exercise, because these networks are huge. In principle, we have mathematical formalism, which is called chemical kinetics. It's a formalism designed to put these networks into equations, but the problem is that for majority of the parameters, we have very vague understanding of the order of magnitude. And we know that for many parameters of these networks, we will never have quantitative estimations. So this is more or less hopeless. There are many approaches which aim to suggest some simplified approach to chemical kinetics formalism, like flux balance analysis, which looks only onto the stoichiometric matrix, some kind of ideas of modularization and abstraction. When I was postdoc here at HUS for 3 years, I had time to think about these kind of approaches, for example, related to the idea of introducing macro variables describing chemical kinetics in analogy to thermodynamics, or use some assumptions about distribution of kinetic parameters and their qualitative relations, which parameter is bigger than which in each fork of reactions, to suggest some asymptotic approximations of chemical kinetics, which made part of this idea of asymptotology asymptotology. There is a misprint of chemical reaction networks, which we worked on together with my ex-scientific advisor. But again, I mean, all this is a part of a very long program. To be pragmatic, people simplify enormously the structure of this biochemical reaction network into simply graphs. And these are a couple of examples of the such simply graphs. So one very simplistic representation of biochemical networks is just to put, it's an undirected graph. I mean, here it's a schizophrenia protein-protein interaction network. So each node in this network is just a protein. It's kind of basic building block of a cell. And the link describes the fact of physical interaction between these two proteins. So if two proteins are interact, it means that it was selected, this interaction was selected by evolution. It means that it can probably serve for certain purpose inside the cell. And large networks like these are called protein-protein interaction networks. Basic mathematical model of these networks are simple undirected graphs. In the type of biology we are dealing with, people do a small step further. They introduce directed graphs where nodes are again proteins, but here the direction gives you an idea of causality, such that one protein can cause change in the function of another protein. So these are another types of networks, and this time they are represented by directed graphs. So these networks that I showed here, some of them are measurable. In principle, it's quite expensive, but some you can measure in a given sample, so you can apply systematically some experiments and derive the structure of the network. And people do it, and it's very interesting. But most of them are constructed not by direct experiment. They are constructed by reading literature. So, I mean, people, because information about these networks is distributed into thousands of publications, people sit, read this, and extract this knowledge in some graphical form. So we do it also in our group for more than 10 years. So we construct a resource which is called Atlas of Cancer Signaling Network. This was an idea that I had when the group has been constructed. And the idea was to construct a kind of world map of biochemical networks involved, implicated into cancer. So this map is called ACSN, or cancer network. So this is the kind of what you see, how this network is organized. Again, it's a large bipartite graph containing more than 10,000 reactions today. But the idea was to embed this network with some pre-designed layout. Of course, this graph is not planar, so you cannot represent it without intersection of edges on a plane. But you can make it approximately planar and organized in such a way that it would reflect our knowledge about biological functions implicated in cancer. And then you can embed this into the system of Google Maps API with the function of semantic zoom, such that when you zoom out, you see more details. When you zoom in, you see more details. When you zoom out, you see kind of more abstracted representation of the network. So what can be the use of this besides just browsing and forming some queries to this network? You can also take some quantitative information that we have about biological networks. For example, you can take a cancerous cell and normal cell, see what are the changes in the concentrations of proteins between two types of cells. Then you will have a number for a protein which will tell you how much this protein changes in terms of presence, concentration between two conditions. Then you can project this information onto this map. And usually, naive form, this visualization is not very insightful. But if you will use the structure of the networks, your connections between proteins to smooth your data, then suddenly you might see some patterns in the data which might be very meaningful. So here, for example, I mean, red color means positive change, green color means negative change, and you immediately see that some functions which are represented on this plot, they are overactivated or downregulated. So this is a very small example how biological networks can be used together with a data that we systematically collect nowadays in cancer research, for example. So this leads me to this kind of introductory slide, where I try to answer the question, what is the use of biological networks in biological data analysis? And I think the central message of this slide is that biological networks allows you to avoid very fruitless discussion about what is biological function. The notion of biological function is central in modern biology. The idea is that all genes in your genome should be labeled with a small sets of functions which they do in a living cell. So for example, I mean, the kind of the dream of biologists is to put several labels on each gene and say that this gene is implicated into this function, this function, this function. Unfortunately, this is a very naive idea because, first of all, many genes involved in many functions, but there is a problem with the idea of biological function itself. The definitions of biological functions are very vague. For many proteins, we don't know what are their biological functions, no idea. Approximately for half of the genes, we still don't have any idea in which functions they're involved. So when we have this large graph connecting proteins, in a way, we can get rid of the idea of biological function because we can say that the function of our protein is a position within the network. So instead of saying what is the function, you can just say that this protein is located in this area of the network and this is its function. So which makes it very useful in to downstream data analysis. So you can combine the information about functional proximity, which is defined by biological network, and the data that you collect on the biological system. So this leads to, the most pragmatic implementation of this idea is a so-called guilty by association principle in analysis of biological data. But not only in biology, this guilty by association principle is used. In Facebook, even if your Facebook page is completely empty, no content, but if you have a list of friends, a lot of things can be inferred from your friendship neighborhood. Same in biology, if you don't know anything about a protein, but you know with which protein this protein interacts, you can tell a lot about the function of the protein. There is a lot of discussion, can we go make step beyond this idea of guilty by association, by direct neighborhood? Can we make two steps from a protein, three steps, and so on? So this leads to the idea of this network propagation or propagation of influence, which would be more distant than a direct neighborhood. So this becomes a main working idea in the field, and there are even reviews. So this is a recent review from Nature about network propagation, a universal amplifier of genetic association. And the first figure of this review, there is this picture which is quite familiar to you, is on which you say that if you know the structure of the network and you have an initial perturbation, then by idea of random walk, you can derive some stationary state in this network which will describe some smooth function which will give you an idea of influence of initial perturbation on the rest of the network. So 10 years ago, we converted this network propagation idea. So our group, as a matter of fact, was one of the first to apply network propagation for data analysis in cancer research, in biological research. So we discussed this idea of using smooth functions defined on the graph. And we suggested a very simple approach, which is analogous to Fourier transformation on graphs. So using the properties of Laplacian of graphs of biological networks, such that if you have some function projected onto the graph of biological network, we can distinguish smooth component on this graph and high frequency component on this graph, and say that we are more interested in this smooth component. So we apply this idea to some classical machine learning tasks. And for example, in this paper, we try to understand the effect of radiation on yeast cells. So these are experiments which was done at Orsay University here. So some systematic measurements were done on non-radiated yeast cells and radiated yeast cells, and we applied classical support vector machine on this data, which by definition, it's not obliged to be behave smoothly on the graph of biological networks, but if you impose smoothness, then the weights of support vector machine will be distributed much smoothly on the graph, which makes the results of your analysis much more insightful. So you can immediately indicate which parts of the biological networks contribute positively, affected positively by radiation, or affected negatively by radiation. In similar project, we use the network smoothing to improve the layout, constructing layouts of biological networks. So layouting networks, since they're quite complex, is a challenging problem because the state of the art force directed layout doesn't frequently give very insightful layouts, and they're not very useful to look at the biological data. So we used an idea of using the data itself to smooth this data using the structure of biological network, and then use this dimension reduction into layouting a biological network on a plane. So this helps to create more insightful layouts of two-dimensional layouts of biological networks. So this is a slide which I use usually to explain to biologists, which are frequently very naive in mathematical formulas, to explain the difference, two main approaches to network propagation. So approach connected to kind of simulating diffusion on a graph, and random walk with restart. So usually I use this analogy with a drop of ink, which you put on one node of the graph, and in diffusion, I mean the stationary state, the ink is uniformly distributed on the graph. So you have to stop somewhere in between to obtain some smooth distributions on the graph. So this is connected to the use of properties of Laplacian. And then there is this idea of random walk with restarts. The most famous implementation of this idea is PageRank and Google Matrix that we all discuss here. So again, this is a simple explanation of how PageRank algorithm works. I'm not going to stop on this. What I would like to show is how this network propagation can serve for very concrete purpose of predicting the effect of mutations on survival of a patient diagnosed with a cancer. So the type of data that we started to obtain relatively recently is genomic information about tumors extracting from the bodies of the patients. So when nowadays a piece of tumor is extracted from the body, it can be characterized in terms of the genome. And one important characterization is how many mutations, so single nucleotide changes in each gene, a current tumor accumulated during evolution of the tumor. So this is a process. Accumulation of mutations is a process which is physiological in a way. So starting from birth, from fertilized egg, each division in principle can bring several mutations into the genome. And when there is a cancer appears in the body somewhere, usually it leads to much faster accumulation of mutations. And when some modern therapy is applied, such as chemotherapy, it can even more trigger the accumulation of mutations. So as a result, so today we have these tables where for a large cohorts of patients, several hundreds of patients, we can characterize the tumor of each patient in terms of the mutations in each gene. And the most frequent representation of this information is just binary matrix, where at the intersection you see which gene is mutated in which tumor. So you can take this is in principle, we believe that these mutations, but part of these mutations are causal for the way the tumor will respond to the therapy, so it can be used for prognosis of how successful will be treatment of the cancer. And but there is a problem with this type of data, and This problem is described on this slide. So if you take simply this matrix, and if you will take y vector, which will give you a number of months a patient survived after treatment of the cancer, and you want to predict this survival in terms of the concordance index. So roughly speaking, concordance index gives you an idea which patient survived longer than so you try to predict for each pairs of patients which patient will survive longer after initial diagnosis of cancer. And of course, if in a random, I mean, if you just make a random guess, the concordance index, the average concordance index will be 0.5. So the point is that if you take a mutation matrix and we are applying some state-of-the-art machine learning method for this matrix to predict this concordance, you can see from this slide that the prediction is very poor. So it's, I mean, basically statistically indistinguishable from random prediction. So somehow this kind of direct application of this data in predicting cancer survival doesn't work. Also, if you will try to cluster this data, for example, if you will try to apply some state-of-the-art matrix factorization techniques for clustering this data, you will fail because the clusters that you will obtain will not be very useful. When you apply clustering, typically your desire is to obtain some clusters which will be more or less equilibrated, such that they would represent some meaningful groups in the data. For this type of data, when you apply clustering, the observed behavior is like this. So you obtain some kind of gigantic cluster and very few clusters which contains one of two patients. So it's not useful for any particular purpose. Yes?
So this is a gene by gene,
like
a cluster?
Your initial matrix is patients by genes. And then, of course, you can define, for example, Euclidean distance based on this vector between two patients and cluster them.
How many genes typically are possible?
In our genome, we have, I mean, it's again discussion, but from 20,000 to 30,000 genes, let's say. Mm-hmm. So this is a kind of dimensionality of the vector. And few hundred samples, usually. So, but, I mean, this is very relevant kind of information because I mean, this slide explains why this clustering of all kind of trying to predict something from this data doesn't work. So first of all, you have two factors which affect this this failure. The first factor is there is a very unequal distribution of total number of mutations. So whatever cancer type you will take, you will profile for mutations, you will find that for some tumors you will find more than thousands of mutations. And for some tumor types, you will find very few mutations. For some tumors, you will find very few mutations. And this heterogeneity in terms of the total burden of mutation rate is a typical characteristic for any collection of tumors that you will take. At least for adult cancers. For pediatric cancers, it might be not the same, but for adult cancers, this is more or less universal picture. So you have a large confounding factor which affects any application of machine learning techniques. Which just means that you need to normalize, pre-process this data somehow to prepare for further analysis. But even more drastic feature of this data is that overlap between mutations is very small. So this is a matrix of overlap patients, so which shows how many mutations two patients have in common. And you see that, I mean, typically you have very few, less than 10 mutations in common between two patients. So which means that mathematically speaking, these data that I showed, this matrix, in terms of multidimensional distribution, forms a very highly dimensional hypercube. And you know that, I mean, apply in a meaningful way machine learning techniques for such distribution of data is not very successful, cannot be very successful. So people think a lot about how to reduce dimension of this hypercube, how to create kind of useful low-dimensional projections of this data. And one of the most productive and, in a way, ingenious ideas was to use biological networks. So the idea is the following. Imagine that you have biological networks which describes, as I have said before, biological function in a way. You can take two patients in this case. Let's take patient one, patient two. So mutations of patient one is shown in red, in yellow color, mutations in patient two shown in blue color. And the co-occurrence of genotype 1 and genotype 2 is shown in green. And just as a model example, you see that on top of this biological network, you have only one co-occurrence. And this symbolically represents more or less what's happening in reality. So you have very few common mutations between two patients, two tumors. Then the idea is that you apply network propagation. So you say that mutation affects not only the node of the network, not only one single node of the network, but it is spread, it influences the function of neighborhood, of some neighborhood. So for example, you can apply, as I will show in the next slide, some random walk-based approach to describe this field of influence. And then instead of binary matrix, this matrix will be converted into some continuous non-negative matrix, which will describe kind of how much mutations are affected the neighborhoods in the graph of a biological network. And then suddenly you will see that the overlap between two genotypes might be very significant in certain parts of the networks. And you can say that this part of the network is affected by mutations. And this changes a lot our ability to cluster the data and also to make predictions out of this data. So this is a kind of trick to utilize this data, which use biological networks. In terms of mathematics, the mathematics of this approach is very simple. So you encode your mutations into what was called the preference vector in the previous talk. So you say that you have a network, you have A and D is mutated. Then you, in this particular work, they apply something which is similar to Google matrix, not exactly the Google matrix approach, but a related approach, just the matrix is differently normalized. So A is a Jancic matrix, D is normalization factor. Also, you have the same alpha, which was taken 0.5 in this particular paper. And then, as a result of application of this random walk strategy, you have a smooth distribution of influences. So, for example, node I, which is relatively distant from mutated nodes, is not affected, but node B, which is close to two mutated nodes, I mean, it receives a higher score. So this is irrational. So we spend two of my colleagues, with Jean-Philippe Vert, who is now became a part of Google Brain headquarter in Paris, and Marine Lumarvan, we try to re-implement this approach and try it on different cancer types. So these are different cancer types that we So these are the different cancer types on which we are tried. So lung cancer, breast cancer, glioma, kidney cancer, and so ovarian cancer, for which we have significant amount of data. We reapply this approach using the state-of-the-art prediction. And you can see that with respect to random prediction, we still not... For many cancer types, it didn't show any change with respect to the previous work, but for two cancer types, you clearly see some benefit from this trick. But also what we learned that you need to apply some normalization. In that case, it was quantile normalization. And also what we discovered that in terms of network propagation, as a matter of fact, using the first neighborhood is already sufficient to achieve this level of prediction. So in this particular application, it is not that useful to use network distances longer than one. So as a matter of fact, this led us to some kind of simplified implementation of this guiltier by association principle using only the first neighborhood information in the network. So in this approach that we suggested, which was published last year, NetNorm, the idea is that you introduce a parameter which is k, which is a kind of a reference number of mutations that you want to introduce in the network. Then if your tumor have less than k mutation, so in this toy example k is 4, this is a small biological network, in this case you have 3 mutations. If you have less than 4 mutations, less than k mutations, that you add a new mutation, which kind of fictitious mutations or proxy mutation, if you want. But you put it into the position which will be most connected to already mutated nodes. So in this case, the most mutated nodes is here, I mean, in terms of neighborhood, and you put a proxy mutation here. And you add as many mutations as you need to achieve a K. If you have more than K mutation, you do the opposite, you remove mutations from your network, and you start removing mutations from the peripheral nodes. So you end up with K mutations, which kind of assigned to the most connected nodes. So the rationale of this approach is very simple. The idea is that if many neighbors of a given node are mutated, that probably its function is also compromised. And also, if your mutation is associated to an orphan node, probably it doesn't affect very much the essential biological function in a given tumor.
Sorry.
Yes.
The underlying network that you consider is gene regulatory network,
or no? In this case, it's a kind of mixture. In this case, it was close to what I depicted. I mean, this network which combines three levels. There are relations of metabolic type, signaling type, and transcriptional regulation type. So it's a mixture of many different types of regulations in the cell. So the network that we used here is quite dense. So as a result, we show that this simple approach already works better than this network propagation reference method. And also, kind of funny questions that we ask ourselves is, what if you would use, instead of biological networks, you would use random networks, just completely rewired networks? I mean, intuitively, you should expect a complete deterioration of the performance of the algorithm, which is not totally the case. Even the funny observation is that even if you use random networks, some kind of random projection of multidimensional data in some kind of random plane, or random low-dimensional space, you still improve your prediction. Nevertheless, biological networks, they perform better than random networks. This is a kind of a positive conclusion from this study. And the method that we suggested, which uses only first neighborhood relations, it benefits from the structure of biological, from the real biological networks much, much more than the state-of-the-art method. Okay. So now I go to Google Matrix, to our collaboration with Dima, Jose, and Klaus on application of Google Matrix and reduced Google Matrix approach to biological networks. So in several studies, we exploited the idea of reduced Google Matrix first of all. We applied it to a reconstruction of a signaling network, which is called Senior. It's a relatively small network, which contains 3,000 nodes, 7,000 of edges. So this is a typical hairball, which you obtain after application of some kind of force-directed layout algorithms. This is a distribution of proteins in the network. Don't pay attention to the colors. Here they don't mean much. On the PageRank chRank plane, you see that there is no correlation between PageRank and chRank. And this is a typical characteristic of biological networks. In biological networks, those nodes which are very influential have many outgoing edges, are usually not the same as those which are tightly regulated and receive many incoming regulations. We know that PageRank is usually proportional to the PageRank value is proportional to the incoming connectivity of a node. But as we see from this graph, there are important deviations from this proportionality law. And for us, it was interesting what kind of patterns in the network lead to deviation from this proportionality rule. And we described several kind of characteristic patterns which lead to the fact that despite very low, relatively low incoming connectivity, the node receives high, very high page rank. So they rank very high in terms of page rank. So there are two kind of stereotypic cases. One case is when a node, here the size of the node is proportional to the page rank, so the bigger it is, the more it's ranked. And the color denotes the ratio between incoming edges and outgoing edges. So if it's red, it means that it receives much more edges than outgoing edges. And you see, so this is a kind of pattern when in a protein is regulated by many already hubs. So I mean, it's a kind of hub of hubs. So it collects influences from many hubs in the network. So many hubs point out to this protein. Another example is when a protein is at the end of the relatively long cascade of regulations. So each protein on this cascade receives a number of regulations, and somehow all these regulations canalizes to the end sync node. So this is another pattern. Or in the opposite, when you see a significant deviation from proportionality rule from the distribution of outgoing edges and J rank, you can detect some proteins which are known, for example, TLR4. Again, these are kind of symbolic names which are given for proteins because we don't know how to name them. But this protein is known as a major trigger of immune system. And there is a very huge cascade of regulation downstream of this node. So by itself, it knows only regulates two proteins, but it obtains very high J rank, or proportionally high J rank, because it regulates many functions downstream. So now so this is a slide explaining a reduced Google matrix, which was already explained before. The idea is that we have a global network and some nodes which we are interested in. We have direct interactions inside this smaller network. But we can also, using this formula and the GQR member of this formula, infer indirect interactions. So we decided to use this approach to see how the structure of reduced of these hidden connections between nodes in the signaling changes in response to between cancer and normal conditions. So as I have said, we have several types of networks. In this case, we analyze the signaling level and transcriptional level. As I have said, transcriptional level we can measure directly experimentally. So in principle, we can take two cells. So in this case, what we did, we took a normal leukocyte and a B cell from a leukemia. So in principle, these are two cells of the same type, but one of these cells behaves like a cancerous cell, and another cell is a normal cell. So by other people, there were measurements of transcriptional network in two types of cells. So we assume that the signaling level remains the same, because as a matter of fact, mutations which happen within cancer cells usually do not affect that much the interface between the proteins, so they interact. The network of interactions between proteins is usually not that much rewired. So we assume that the signaling network has the same structure, but at the level of transcription, there might be many changes happening. So the transcriptional network might be very different between a normal cell and a cancerous cell. So this is a kind of multiplex network, if you want. So we have same set of nodes connected at one level by the interactions from the signaling level, and then the last level by the interactions from the transcriptional regulation level. So as a result, you can substitute the transcriptional level, and you can study it in normal cell and in cancer cell, and you can see how the structure of hidden connections will change. So in the end, you can introduce small nomenclature. You can say that you might have hidden interactions which do not change between normal cell and cancer cell. You can have hidden interactions which would emerge as a response to cancer, or you can have interactions which would disappear in oncogenic network. And we thought that this is very interesting information to have a look at. Also, what you can study is how PageRank changes between normal condition and cancer condition. So some of the nodes you expected to improve their page rank, it means that they will be more regulated in cancer. And some nodes will be decrease their page rank, so which means that they will be less regulated in cancer. All this is an interesting information to have a look. But before having a look at this, we looked, so this is a picture showing change of J rank and page rank between normal and cancer conditions for the same cell type, related to leukemia, of course. And one of the first observations that the log ratio of J rank changes was 3 times, so between three orders of magnitude, larger than PageRank changes. So which indicates that in cancer, the most of the changes are happening in the transcriptional network at the level of outgoing edges, which means that, I mean, some proteins which are potent regulators of multiple biological processes, they completely rewired between norm and cancer. So in another small study, we took a set of genes which are all known to be proliferation genes, and these are direct connections between genes, so which just indicate one very known hub in this network, CDK1. Again, I'm not going to explain what this protein means, what this means, but what you can see is that just using information about direct interactions, you just infer existence of one particular hub, which is very well known. If you will use a reduced Google matrix approach, you see that, first of all, the genes which are involved in proliferation, they are much more tightly connected between each other. You see emergence of other hubs, which is kind of added value of reduced Google matrix approach. But also what is interesting is that you see examples of disappearing interactions between norm and cancer. For example, in this case, it's so these interactions which were detected, they are here. And you can see that one protein, which is in biology is known to be mitotic spindle checkpoint regulator, whatever it means, it doesn't regulate function of these proteins anymore, this and this. As a result, their page rank decreases, so they are less regulated, which might indicate to you some strategy of improving the situation with this particular leukemia, cancer type leukemia, by acting on the regulation of these particular proteins. It doesn't tell you what you should do with these proteins, kind of improve their concentration or decrease their concentration, but at least it indicates that this is a potential intervention point. Okay, so now I switch to the final topic of my presentation, which will be about Wikipedia. And we had already many talks about Wikipedia. And I must say that for me, Wikipedia is very exciting object, because it somehow represents human knowledge in a graphical form. Of course, it's, I mean, kind of characteristic vision of human knowledge, very incomplete and so on. But at least probably this is the best that we have for the moment, represented in a formal way. And there are many things that we can learn from Wikipedia, despite the fact that, I mean, only known facts are put in the Wikipedia as a content, but the structure of connections between pages is something that can be studied and can be used to infer some knowledge. For example, I mean, the one funny example that I found when I was preparing this presentation is about just take a Wikipedia page with some enigmatic title. I mean, for some of you it's not enigmatic, of course, but transhumanism, for example. And makes three steps from this article in Wikipedia network, construct a network of interactions in the Wikipedia, connections in Wikipedia around this transhumanism, which will give you definition of transhumanism. So without knowing what is transhumanism, you will know what it is by looking at this kind of neighborhood. Just funny example. Of course, if you know what is transhumanism, it's not useful. But imagine for proteins. For many proteins, we know very little about what they do. So in case of proteins, such objects have proteins, this approach might be much more interesting to apply. Again, instead of looking on one particular page, you can take a set of pages. In this case, I took cat, dog, coyote, rabbit, just some random imagination. So these are direct links. From direct links, you don't learn much about these. But if you look at the hidden links of indirect connections between two pages, you can immediately learn that these animals have paws, they have fur, they are mammals. Some of them are subject of selective breeding. Some of them can be characterized in terms of predatory relations. Some of them live in grassland in North America. So kind of immediately, just by looking at second neighborhood of these nodes, connecting this group of pages, you already can learn a lot. So our temptation was to use this rationale to understand the relations between proteins. And indeed, within Wikipedia, there are approximately 10,000 pages devoted to proteins. So this is one of them, protein, some filamin A. Again, it doesn't mean much. I mean, you cannot guess what does it does in the cell in the, just from its name. But what is interesting is usually in the bottom page of this protein, you see known interactions of this protein with other proteins. So there is a section. So which means that you already have those interactions that we know, that are characterized, already somehow encoded in Wikipedia, usually in automatic fashion. So it's kind of extraction from existing pathway databases, which are automatically inserted into these pages. This information, I mean, it's a semi-manual process. So people might add, of course, these interactions, but usually it comes from existing databases. So if you look at the structure of direct interactions, it's no surprise in Wikipedia, in the protein-protein interaction network embedded into Wikipedia. You will see this hairball, which will be, by all topological measures, by all characteristics, very similar to existing and to known reconstructions of protein-protein interactions. So in this sense, it's interesting that inside Wikipedia you have protein-protein interaction network, but by itself, this network of direct interactions is not very interesting because most probably it's just a reflection of what was put there from some existing protein-protein interaction networks. Nevertheless, we can take advantage of the fact that this network of protein-protein interactions is embedded into the network of human knowledge. And it's interesting to ask, does it bring anything in addition? Our conclusion was that it does. So even if you look at the structure of hairball, which are normalized by density, so we select as many hidden links, the strongest hidden links, such that the density of this hairball would be the same as the density of the direct connections. You see that the hairballs are not quite the same, and you can see already existence of certain communities inside this, this graph. So this is interesting because it means that by indirect links, these proteins are connected not in the same way as by direct links. And you can demonstrate it more or less explicitly by looking at the degree distribution, which have this particular pattern in the hidden links connections. You can look also at the average clustering coefficient, which is high in hidden network, and the average connectivity of nodes. Also, you can see that there is a systematic bias towards higher connectivity, higher clustering into the hidden networks, which means that somehow the environment, the neighborhood of proteins in Wikipedia defines the notion of a function because it defines communities of proteins. And this is probably kind of, this knowledge might be exploited for definition of function. So for example, you can cluster your network of hidden interactions and it will give you more or less well-defined communities. And it's surprisingly easy to put labels onto these communities. So the largest community that you have is devoted to immune systems, and there is a community devoted to cell cycle, glucagon metabolism, GTPase signaling, potassium ion transport, which is important for brain function, apoptosis, coagulation, keratin, peroxisome. So in principle, all these communities are quite, they are quite natural from the biological point of view, which is not a big surprise because they are connected indirectly by some common knowledge links. Nevertheless, it's very useful because this community structure is not explicitly present into protein-protein interaction itself. So there is an added value of this connectivity pattern inside Wikipedia, which might be used for defining what is biological function. Also, we studied at the difference between 2013 version of Wikipedia the 2017 version of Wikipedia, we found that most of the communities have quite a good match. Though we had some surprises. For example, in 2017 we discovered a new kind of super community which connected proteins which were not at all, which were very loosely connected in the previous version of Wikipedia. So we tried to understand what is the nature of this kind of largest community. But also we looked out of curiosity how we can automatically annotate these communities. Because, for example, let's take this coagulation-related community. And again, these are the list of proteins which are involved in it. And if you've never studied biology, I mean, these names might be completely out of meaning for you. It doesn't give you any a priori reference. But if you will look at second order neighborhood, which connects these proteins by indirect reactions, you see these all these labels which appear in the Wikipedia, from the Wikipedia. First of all, you can find the schema of coagulation, which is a kind of textbook image about coagulation, which connects all these factors into a cascade. You can see what are the diseases associated to this community. You can even find a person who was the most visible, the most famous person studying coagulation. You can learn that these coagulation factors are produced in liver. You can see what are the drugs which are used to treat coagulation problems and so on. So this is by itself is an interesting kind of complement to what we can learn about the structure of these communities. Another example is about this community in the network. Again, names of proteins, if you didn't study biology, are completely without any reference, but you can learn by this analysis that it's related to cell migration, and cell migrates through extension of phyllopodia and changing the cell polarity. Again, what about this community, super community, which appeared in the version 2017? It was funny because first observation that you make that in the center of this community, the most central node is myoglobin, so which might indicate that between 2013 and 2017 there was a major discovery in terms of myoglobin function. But as a matter of fact, it looks more like an artifact, because what you can conclude is that if you look at the structure of what explains these hidden connections, this is a network of hidden connections. So these hidden connections point to myoglobin. But if you look what is between these proteins and myoglobin, you see basically two pages. And one page is called protein-protein interaction, another page is called protein. So apparently between in these 4 years, between 2013 and 2017, a lot of content was put into these two pages. So they increased by size, by order of magnitude. So they have much more links and much more proteins are connected to these two pages now. And on both pages, myoglobin is presented as an example of the first protein whose structure was deciphered in terms of crystallography. So this explains the appearance, emergence of this super community, which combines proteins without any obvious biological function. Okay, my conclusions is that network propagation is a powerful tool which allows to jointly analyze the data that we have today in cancer research and somehow introduce into this analysis our knowledge, which will be free from the very rigid definition of biological function. Second, fortunately or unfortunately, it seems in most of the applications that first neighbors already give you enough information to make predictions and to use these biological networks. So I highlighted this notion of creative elements. So those elements which are not that tightly connected into biological networks, nevertheless, they obtain high page rank or chain rank, and this creates these nodes interesting. This story of Wikiprotein hidden communities. I think there is an added value of looking into Wikipedia in order to understand what is the consensus definition of biological function in the community. Because Wikipedia is a result of collective work, and somehow, as you could see, there is an emergence of these communities inside Wikipedia devoted to particular biological functions. So these are the people who were involved in this work, including those people present here. So this is a waterfall which is called Hell Waterfall. Danfer. And other people from our group which made some pieces of the work that I have presented. So thank you very much. I'm ready to answer your questions.
As you worked with Jean-Philippe Vert, do you use canal methods for graphs?
Not in this project that I mentioned, but of course, I mean, he one of his famous kind of tools that he introduced into computational biology is indeed the graph-based kernels that you can immediately insert into any classifier or any PCA or whatever dimension reduction technique, and indeed sometimes it's very constructive.
So one question I have is, looks like most of this information is in the form of network, so it's in the form of pairwise interaction. Mm-hmm. In some cases, you have combinatorial functions in biology, like, say, regulation of simultaneous regulation mm-hmm. of the gene bank.
Yes, yes.
Things, so protein complexes with mm-hmm. Many proteins doing mm-hmm. assembly to the. So, do you think there is a sense in which these approaches might be blind to this higher order interaction? There is a sense of going towards higher order interactions?
Indeed, these high-order interactions, there might be complex patterns of wiring these interactions. We exploit these high-order interactions into constructing so-called logical models, when we try to introduce logical rules on how combination of inputs leads to the change of the function of the downstream proteins. There you explicitly take into account this combinatorial nature of interactions. Here, to what extent you use it here, probably you don't, but maybe Dima can complement on this.
So, if there are no other questions?
Finally, actually, it is very similar to your question. Actually, the network of chemical reactions is essentially a bipartite
yes, yes.
But with this, with hyper H,
yes.
Directed in complex way hyper H, so that for me it's not very easy to understand how, in principle, it's possible to approach this mm-hmm. Google Page Ranking for such object.
We don't apply directly to stoichiometric networks, to these bipartite networks, indeed. But I mean, this approach that I mentioned, flux balance analysis, for example, it deals directly with stoichiometric matrix, which takes into account this bipartite nature of the graphs, which also can be used to highlight some central nodes into the chemical reaction networks. But indeed, directly, it's not applicable. But once again, I mean, in theory, we have this chemical kinetics formalism, bipartite graphs, and so on. But if you look at what information we have at large scale, usually it's formalized in the form of these simple influence graphs that protein A causally related to the function of protein B. And we still lack a lot of details behind these regulations.
Okay, so I think it's time to thank the last speaker. And probably it's time to thank also the organizers of this workshop.
Thank you.